Hi, everybody. Welcome back. It's Dr. Kieran. We're going to talk about the second consequence of hormonal poverty, and that is disease. Midlife metabolic mayhem, which we covered in the last episode, is the 60 plus symptoms that you might be experiencing due to hormonal poverty. And we're going to go more into detail into many of those symptoms in other episodes. But the second consequence, if you're just having symptoms, that's why I like to say your symptoms are the gifts, they are the blessings, because they're pointing the way to the problem. So when you pay attention to them, they actually are gifts. And when you fix them, you not only get rid of those symptoms, but you get rid of all the untoward consequences that those causes will cause in the future, which is disease. And that's the second consequence of hormonal poverty. So I like to call, you know, hormones, we like to categorize in medicine hormones into different categories. So one category is the corticosteroids, which includes cortisol, DHEA, that's what we call them. Then we have the mineralocorticoids, which is aldosterone, which regulates your water and mineral balance in your kidneys. And then we have the sex hormones, which are the sex steroid hormones, and that's estrogen, progesterone, testosterone. And we like to put them in these categories as if every cell and every system in your body didn't need these hormones as communicators. Your body doesn't discriminate between, oh, it's a mineralocorticoid, I'm only going to send it to the kidneys. Oh, it's a corticosteroid, I'm only going to send it like cortisol to your hair, right? Or your heart. It doesn't work like that. Anything you put in your body goes everywhere in your body, right? I think we'll agree. Just like if you put a drop of red dye in a glass of water, does only one part where you put the drop turn red? No, the whole cup. You are a system in its entirety that has integrity and is whole. So when you have hormonal poverty and you have the symptoms of midlife metabolic mayhem, if they go on unchecked, never mind you're taking Ambien to knock you out, never mind you're taking something for your gut dysfunction, you're on an antidepressant, you're on a birth control to control your crazy crime scene periods, and you claim victory because the symptom is suppressed, your body still has the same impoverished state going on, and it's going to cause problems. So second consequence it can cause is disease. And that's when all these symptoms are allowed to go on and all these functional problems are accruing over time. And then they, whoop, now all of a sudden you have a disease and you're at the doctor and the doctor's like, oh, checking your eyes. Oh my gosh, you have macular, you're starting to have macular degeneration. Like it comes out of the blue. And what I like to say is it doesn't come out of the blue. It comes out of the oblivious, because you think you go to your annual exam every year at the doctor. They listen to your heart, listen to your lungs, tap on your belly, check your reflexes, stick a speculum in your vagina, do a pap smear, and they tell you you're looking great and we didn't find anything. And you're like, I'm so healthy. And what I want to say is, no, you are not. If you have symptoms and you are on medications, or if you don't feel amazing at every age, you are not so healthy. And so, you know, by the time that exam that your doctor does, and even if they do blood work, they are looking for disease. They are looking for what? What is the diagnosis? What drug do I need to give? What surgery do I need to do? If you are not checking your health for functional problems before they become a disease, you are missing the boat and you will not experience the health that is possible for you. And this is why you're stuck in this midlife metabolic mayhem and maybe accruing a disease. So hormonal poverty increases the risk of getting 7 of the top 10 causes of death for women. Things, you know, most women are most concerned about breast cancer, and we're going to talk about that. But first, I want to say that I like to call, I don't like the term sex hormones, because that puts in our mind that it's only about sex. It's only about me having periods and having a baby and breastfeeding the baby. That's all it's about. And it's about so much more. I like to call them flex hormones, because using them is like flexing one of the biggest muscles in your body. So you want to flex your hormones, and I call them flex hormones. So when you hear me say flex hormones, that's what I'm talking about. But it's all the hormones. They're all flex. Like corticosteroids aren't only about, your cortisol is not only about stress. It's about so much more. It's about your immune system function. Bet you didn't know that. They're all flex hormones. They're communicators. Like just think about in your family, you don't just communicate, you know, with your kids and not your partner, you communicate with everybody. So do you give one name to the communication that you have with your kids and another name to the communication you have with your partner? No, it's all communication. So it's flex hormones. So let's start from the top and go down. Brain. There are flex hormone receptors in your brain, and Alzheimer's is the seventh leading cause of death among older women. Studies show that flex hormone therapy for 6 years or more reduces the risk of this disease by 79%, and programs have been developed that address all the causes of hormonal poverty that impact the brain. And they have some published data that's really impressive on fixing hormonal poverty. Now, they don't call it that, but I look at it and I say, oh yeah, they're looking at fixing hormonal poverty. And when they fix it, reduce risk of Alzheimer's and some reversal of Alzheimer's. Now, I'm not going to sit here and say, you know, if you have advanced Alzheimer's, you're going to do those things and you're going to get back to normal. I would never say that. But can you get improvement? Because, and here's why this is important. Dysfunction with your health happens on a continuum. It doesn't happen overnight. You don't wake up one night, oh my God, I have Alzheimer's. You are walking down the path to Alzheimer's usually for 5, 10, 20, 30, 50 years before you get a diagnosis of Alzheimer's. But nobody was doing any test to evaluate you for the functional problems that were going on that were accruing to cause that. It's the same even with diabetes. It wasn't like you woke up one day and you were diabetic, although you feel that. Right? You think that. It's not. You are heading down the path, road to diabetes is what I call it, for 5, 10, 20, 30, maybe more years. But nobody was doing the right tests and helping you to turn around on that road and go back the right way. So by the time you get to having an actual diagnosis of Alzheimer's, you have brain lesions that are anatomic. So disease occurs on a continuum, starting with functional problems that are small and might give you symptoms. And then if that's not addressed, it goes on and on and on till it becomes an anatomic problem that you can see neurofibrillary tangles on an MRI or plaques in the brain. Right? That's an anatomic problem. By the time you get an anatomic problem, can you reverse it completely? A lot of times, no. Like arthritis, osteoarthritis, by the time you have no cartilage in your knee joint, can you get cartilage in there again? Well, we're starting to do some work with stem cells, and there's some data that says we can rebuild cartilage with stem cells, and they're looking at all kinds of treatments for that. But for the most part, once you have an anatomic problem, to completely reverse it might not happen. Stem cells do show promise with that. But if you catch things when they're in their functional stage, that's best. But then they go on to become a disease and an anatomic problem. You can get improvement a lot of times, but maybe not complete reversal. It just depends. Like if you're just diagnosed with diabetes, we see people all the time get where they don't have diabetes. So let's start with the brain. So just that was a reality check. I don't want you to anyone who watches this to say, oh, Dr. Kieran said I have Alzheimer's and I cannot have it if I do this. I didn't say that, but you can improve it. And if you don't have that diagnosis yet, you can turn back around and get off that highway, right? You don't have to go down it. So Alzheimer's increased. You have flex hormone receptors in your eyes. Macular degeneration is the leading cause of blindness among older women. And addressing the hormonal poverty causing that makes macular degeneration 50% less likely to occur, right? Your heart, heart disease, heart attack is the number one killer of women over 50. And if you address your hormonal poverty, for at least 10 years, you have a reduced risk of heart attack and heart failure. And a study was published in the British Medical Journal about that. Most women are not afraid about heart disease and heart attacks, even though it is the number one thing that's going to cause us problems. But many women are afraid of breast cancer. It's highly publicized, and there's a lot of fear among women around breast cancer. My grandmother had breast cancer. I never even got to meet her because she passed away before I died. And she was at a young age. So I always had this fear as well. And maybe you have your own story of a family member, loved one, community member who got breast cancer. So it seems to be something we talk about way more often than heart disease. You don't hear that often. I'm not sure entirely why that is, and I would love to hear your thoughts, but why aren't we talking about heart disease? Because that's the thing that's most likely to give us problems in the future, not our breasts. But there was a big study, and we'll go into this in another episode in detail, done several years ago, that focused around estrogen therapy that really scared women about their breasts and cancer. And the study was faulty. We will go into that into another episode, talking about why women are so afraid of breast cancer, and unnecessarily so, really. But in the years since that study was done, there have been a lot of retractions and corrections to that study. And the bulk of the literature and research on flex hormone therapy shows that there is a reduced risk when you get out of hormonal poverty and into hormonal prosperity. There's a reduced risk of breast cancer. And we'll talk about in detail what cancer is and how does it happen to you and what makes you susceptible. And we act like a lot of women believe that, oh, it's an estrogen problem. No. And I'm just going to give you a little reality check on that. Every man, woman, and child on the face of this planet has estrogen. If estrogen caused breast cancer, every man, woman, and child on the face of this planet would have breast cancer. Do they? They don't. So it's not an estrogen problem. And we're going to talk about what is the problem, and we'll go into that in depth. A lot of people aren't familiar with the fact that their immune system requires hormonal communication to function optimally. So if you are in hormonal impoverishment, your immune system doesn't function and protect you as well. One of the things it doesn't function and protect you well against as well against is cancer. Cancer is a failure of your immune system. And I know a lot of you, that's the first time you're hearing it. You're like, what? Wait a minute, Kieran. And we'll talk about it in another episode. But cancer is an immune system failure. And so is getting any serious viral or bacterial infections, right? So if your immune system is robust, you don't get sick. And it amazes me how often people think of getting sick regularly as just normal. It is not normal to get the flu every year. It's just not. It's not normal to get a sinus infection. Well, let me say this. It's normal, but it's not what's possible or optimal. Normal means what most people experience, and most people get sick at least once a year, if not more often. But that's not what's optimal. And it's very interesting with COVID infection. Women who were addressing their hormonal poverty had a lower fatality rate compared to those who didn't. So they less often got COVID, and they had less severe COVID, and they died less often. So addressing your hormonal poverty affects all areas of your life. And lastly, we'll talk about bones. They have these flex hormone receptors. And if you have bone thinning, osteopenia, osteoporosis, which you should be getting screened for, which there really isn't a standardization of recommendations for that. But if you're 50, over 50, or you have risk factors, you have small bone structure, you're petite, white, Caucasian or Asian, you're at more increased risk. You want to get screened with a central bone density. I'll just put a plug in for that. But if you're addressing your hormonal poverty, you have a reduced risk of getting a hip fracture by about 55%. Now, why is this a big deal? I know some of you might think of it as that something that only happens to older people. Yeah, well, at some point you're going to be that older person if you're lucky enough. And 1/3 of women who fall and have a hip fracture will die from it. 1/3 will become hospitalized and incapacitated to the point that they can no longer live independently. That's pretty significant. So it is a serious health consequence. So every cell, every system in your body depends on your hormones, flex hormones, for proper communication, for proper and optimal metabolism. You need your metabolism to turn energy into ATP so that your body can fund its repair, right? It has to repair things. Every day you encounter insults that have to be corrected and fixed and made optimized so you can be vitally alive and healthy. And how does this, what does this look like when you do correct it? Well, it looks like hormonal prosperity. That's the weight you want, the energy you want, the hair, the peace of mind, the cognitive expertise. It's the gut peace and health. It's your whole body being vitally alive so that you can be in your life, enjoy it, and empowered to do the things that you want to do, the things you want to experience. And so if you are hormonally impoverished and you might be accruing these problems, maybe you don't have a diagnosis yet. Maybe you already have a diagnosis. You want to be addressing that. But if you're ignoring those symptoms of midlife metabolic mayhem we talked about, you're walking down the road to some disease, and then you're going to go to your doctor and they're going to tell you, oh, you have blank, and you're going to go into a fear response. And then you're going to start looking for what's the answer. And one last story I'll leave you with is I had this colleague who was a general surgeon when I practiced mainstream OBGYN, and we used to do surgery together sometimes on more difficult cases. She was an amazing woman. She actually had another career in an artistic field. And then when her son got old enough, he wanted to go to medical school, and she always wanted to go to medical school. So she literally, when her kid was old enough to go to medical school, enrolled in medical school, became a general surgeon. She was an amazing human being. Well, I saw her one day at the local health food store in our town, which I'm in all the time. And I had never seen her there. And I said, well, what are you doing here? I'll call her Jane. That's not her real name. Jane, what are you doing here? And she said, oh, I was diagnosed with colon cancer. And this is after I stopped going to the hospital because I no longer did drug and surgery medicine. I did root cause resolution medicine. So I had no need to go to the hospital. So I saw her there and she said, oh, I was diagnosed with colon cancer and I had to have a partial colectomy. And now I'm here looking for some herbs and vitamins that can help me to recover. And, you know, it was lovely to see her. I was sorry to hear about her diagnosis. And I tried to see, was there anything I could help her with? And we had a little reconnection chat, but I left there so sad because I thought to myself, what if she had been in this store looking at things to help the root causes of the symptoms she was ignoring, her symptoms of midlife metabolic mayhem? I promise you there were signs pointing to the fact that her immune system was struggling and that she could be at risk for developing a cancer. But she probably ignored them, like a lot of you are, and was medicating them, like a lot of you are, or might be. And then, oh, she got this bomb dropped into her life. You have colon cancer. And then her whole life changed. And that's when I find a lot of people really start to take this seriously. And so my message to you is don't wait until the boulder drops in your life to take this seriously. You don't have to wait for the heart disease diagnosis, the hip fracture diagnosis, the macular degeneration blindness diagnosis, the cancer diagnosis. Pay attention to the pebbles. Those are your symptoms. Hear them? Doot, 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 doot in your life. And get about figuring out, am I in hormonal poverty? And if I am, why am I in hormonal poverty? And what do I need to do about it? So I don't have to get the boulder disease diagnosis. Or the third consequence of hormonal poverty, which you're really not going to like when you hear about it. Every woman I tell about it says, oh my God, my doctor didn't tell me that. And you're going to say that too. So we're going to talk about that in the next episode. Hopefully you got a lot of value out of this and you're really starting to get a good idea of what is hormonal poverty and why should I care about this? Thank you so much for joining me. I'll see you in the next episode. Until then. Peace, love, and hormones, y'all.